Okay? So you'll have that on the back. So now you're all equipped. You got the ballot initiative in your hand, and it will have pockets where the it'll fit nicely in the pocket. And you'll wear this vest you put on top of your normal garments. And so you'll go to a mall, and you'll walk up to a lady, and you'll say, "Ma'am, would you like to vote to empower yourself?" Well, she'll say, "Well, what do you mean? We already have the initiative." Well, this is an improvement on it, because you'll be able to do it independent of representative government. She says, "Well, I don't know about that." Well, that's okay. Don't let me interrupt you. Here, I'll give you a leaflet here that will explain this process. And if you're convinced that you want to be empowered, then the next time you see somebody with this little jacket, go up to them and ask if you could vote. Not a petition, not a take poll, you're actually voting. And then when they vote on this document, you peel off one sheet, you give it back to them so they have their signature, the date, and they've entered their email address or phone numbers if they want to, and then you have a copy of a signed vote. And so when you get 51% or more, now politically what you do is once you got 50%, let's say in September, you keep the vote going, get 60%. Because the more people you get committed to the process, the more power it will have politically on the representative government. And so you keep that process going as long as you can. And then at the end of that process, whoever is the committee that put this together in Switzerland, and it will be Swiss people, I will just advise, they will do it. And then when they have enough votes, they will write a letter to the government of Switzerland and all the cantons and saying, "This is now the law of the land. End of story. And now appropriate the money to pay for the cost of the Citizens Trust, which is the agency that will administer the procedures on behalf of the people." You see, the reason why direct democracy has failed in the United States at the state level, and it fails in Switzerland at its present level, is because they said, well, the agency that will administer the procedures will be representative government. So you have now put the wolves guarding the hen house, and they will make sure that it always operates to their benefit. But now if you say they're going to be independent, and what makes them independent is the trust is only for the people. And so when the people make laws, they're totally independent of representative government. Representative government will make its laws, but as I pointed out earlier, the people become the senior partners. And if this representative government does not act properly, they can then do what somebody was suggesting, throw them out, pass another amendment, and that's the end of them. But you'll not see that happen, because politicians are very clever. They want to keep their jobs. And so what they'll do is they'll follow the leadership of the people, and they will conduct themselves a lot better than they are. Because you see, under the procedures of the initiative that I've written, there are no monies, only money from a natural person can be used in the election. Only money from a, now that's, I see you smiling, you know, that's code for forget all of this corporate money. And then what's one of the first initiatives we would pass? Is we change this whole corporate personhood so that corporations are down where they belong, not equal to the people. That's an initiative we could do. I mean, we'd be so busy doing initiatives just correcting the fundamental problems that, I mean, it would be, you get giddy just thinking of the possibilities of what would happen. And so that's what happens if you just concentrate on getting the tool. Forget the issues. Get the tool to be able to exercise the fundamental, the central power of government, which is lawmaking. Once you got that tool, you can take care of it. And that's where it's an act of faith with me. I have unreserved faith in the people. And I know scientifically that they can do a better job in their self-governance than their leaders are presently doing. So, but they'll make mistakes. I don't represent that I'm changing human nature, not at all. But I do think I've got a device that will improve human nature. Because if you give people a good tool, they'll do good things. If you give them a bad tool, they'll do bad things. And that's what's involved in this whole process. And I've got more attention on this this issue in the last 5 months than I've had in the last 20 years. And all I want to do is live to see it come into being. That's all. Then I'll die a happy man. Please.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, you've been lucky today. I got a really burning question. That is,
oh, well then.
Yeah. I'm sitting on it, yeah. I mean, this tool is a very great tool, as I can think of. But we all know that information is a very important point. And this new legislation, these new laws, will acquire more than 50% of the people voting for something. We use a technology warrior, but how? What is your thought about the role of the media in informing people? Because people are misinformed, so they will all. There's always a chance that they will vote incorrectly or.
You're raising two parts of it. Yeah. You're raising how the people will conduct themselves when they have the legislation, the mental legislation in power. Okay. Then there's the other part, which is what I'm talking about, which is to enact the mental legislation. So I ran for president, not because I wanted to be president, because the president can't do anything, the Congress, you know. So what I was running for president was to be able to tell people about the national initiative. I was in seven debates, and I mentioned this in every debate, and not once did the media ask me a question about it. They asked my views about the war, the this and that, but not that. And so the media is in the same situation as we all are in. What I'm talking about is new and out of the box. It doesn't exist in the world today. So the media is uninformed. Now, let me tell you how, first off, if you can raise enough money, you can begin to get media influence, okay? But it's better than that, it's easier. When the media in Zurich and Geneva and Basel, when they see people walking around with these blue vests offering to let people to vote, you don't think the media is not going to say, what's going on there? And they'll begin to study it and realize, my God, this is a phenomenon. This is a little bit like the Occupy. You know, the first few years, the first few months, they didn't give it any press. And now it commands the press of the world. And so the same process. The media is in a position very imperfectly because it's corporate controlled. Now, they could shut it off, but it won't work. It won't work. The people will see, because we're asking the people not to listen to the media. We're asking you to make a decision on voting. And if you want to empower yourself, fine. If you don't, fine. If people don't want to take on this responsibility, you can't force them.
People are very easily influenced by
it. Now you're talking after you got the power.
Yeah.
You're maintaining that you're going to, I got to tell you, you're not going to be easily influenced. Because in the law, we have a procedure to inform people as to what's going on. This law was written over 7 years, and we made no compromises. And so if you had Warren Buffett spent $1 billion opposed to an initiative that you and others wrote, and Bill Gates spent $1 billion on the other side of the, won't make any difference. Because you see, once you provide sufficient communication processes to be able to inform the people, they will identify their self-interest, and you can't bribe the people. Now, if you bribe the people, it means that you are going in the same direction they are, what they already want. Now, you can bribe and own legislatures, but you can't bribe the majority of the people. And that's the dynamic. And I can give you examples of that in legislation that took place in California and others. We have passed about almost 1,500 pieces of legislation in 100 years. You're going to see an interesting phenomenon. When the people are empowered to make laws, you will witness an interesting phenomenon. They will become more conservative than the Conservative Party or the Liberal Party. Why? Because they will understand that when you're talking about solving a problem, you want to take my money And the people are smarter than that. And they'll recognize that also not every problem can be solved with a law, a new law on top of a law on top of a law. So you'll see a phenomenon that will take place, and I can prove this by experience. We had 1,500 initiatives in the last 100 years in the United States. Not one of these initiatives were the people acting irresponsibly with respect to money. Not one. Okay? And the 1,500 initiatives only represented 40% of those initiatives that were qualified, not the several thousand that were initiated. So, no, the people will take a different approach, and because it's acting responsibly, and they will. Lord Acton, a very famous philosopher, writer, political scientist, at the turn of the century, he's the one that wrote the statement, made the statement that power corrupts and absolute power corrupts absolutely. Okay. He also made another statement. He was dead wrong. He said that democracy will fail because the people will recognize that they control the purse. They'll open the purse, shower themselves with all the money in the treasury, and bankrupt democracy. Well, that's not happened in 100 years, either in Switzerland or in the United States. But what has happened is the representative government has made the United States bankrupt today, New York City bankrupt, Orange County bankrupt, you name the cities around the world that are bankrupt, or the governments that are bankrupt, and who did that was representative government. And let me give you one piece of advice. When you hear people talk about direct democracy, and they tell you all the bad things that will happen, they don't know what will happen because we don't have it anywhere in the world. And what they're describing is the negatives that occur with representative government, and they're foisting them on the people. But there's never been. So I think that we've used up our time. Am I correct? And I'd like to close with your permission, leader. Okay.
I have one little question.
Oh, okay, little one. No big one, little one.
How react people you meet in a country when a senator is talking about 9/11 the way you do?
I still get the same shutdown that you get. The media won't cover me. They'll cover me because I'm a former senator or got some celebrity status for running for president and all of that, and I'm very controversial. So I get that coverage. But the 9/11 truth movement, we're very happy when I came aboard because, oh boy, now we're going to get some media attention. Well, I don't bring it. I didn't bring it to the table with me, and I can't force the issue. Now, I get media attention when I talk about the national initiative, when I talk about other issues like the war with Iran that's being juiced up by Obama and Netanyahu. I get that attention, but I get the same treatment that... Lori, when you tie into what took place in Toronto, Lori Manuel, who spoke just before me, is a psychologist, and she was the organizer of this an awesome lady. And she discussed why people cannot get their hands around a new investigation. And it's an interesting psychological phenomenon. I don't claim to be an authority on that subject. I'm more the confrontational guy, just push ahead. But she gave a great analysis just before I spoke, and I would commend that to you for your
little... I've seen it, yeah.
You've seen it, okay. Well, I can't do any better than she's done.
Okay. I would like to ask one more question. Because
that's okay.
You're talking about nations, how you can create new ways of voting nationwide, but I think 9/11 and the bank crush, everything that's happening right now is aimed at creating a one world government, which will take away more power from the people, more power from the nations. And talking about 9/11, first they call it the Freedom Tower, and now they call it One World Trade Center, One World Government Trade Center, I think.
Well, so it's One World Government.
They got it bigger, yeah. And fewer people controlling.
Well, it's one world government like you've got the EU run in Brussels, okay? You don't have any say, it's top down. That's the one world government they're talking about. The one world government I'm talking about is real simple. We have the technology where the people of the world can legislate. And so when we look at the United Nations, which is controlled by five countries,